Good morning, everyone. Bright and early, thank you for being here Thursday morning for our session on mega regional trade agreements and the implications in the services area for third countries. We're here on a bright and sunny day in Nairobi, and we hope to have a very good discussion on this important topic. The ICTSD is pleased to organize this session on services, and I'm pleased and very happy to have on the panel many experts who have thought a lot about the services issue, and I think you'll find this a very interesting discussion. We thought that this panel would be useful because of the mega regional trade agreements that are now at the forefront of the world economy and the important implications that they may have and their impacts, both economic and in terms of governance, on non-participating countries. So this session intends to address the implications for third countries of these mega regional trade agreements that are currently under negotiation. And we've included for this discussion basically three and extended it to a fourth. And these are the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, that was recently concluded amongst 12 countries in the Asia Pacific, the TTIP, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, that is being negotiated between the EU and the United States, so 29 countries, the RCEP, the Regional Cooperation Economic Partnership, which is being negotiated amongst 10 ASEAN countries and 6 external partners in East Asia, or the TiSA, the Trade and Services Agreement Negotiations, that are being negotiated among 53 countries in Geneva, all members of the WTO. So we would like to examine the potential impact of these agreements on services, both in terms of market access, as well as what they might imply for changed governance frameworks. So our panelists are going to consider the possible options open to non-member developing countries, in particular as they contemplate how to address these agreements. We fear that there's a strong risk of marginalization for many countries in the age of mega regionals, especially the lesser developed. Of the 196 countries in the world, 52 of them are participants in one of the two imminent mega regionals, that is the TPP and the TTIP, and 62 if RCEP is included. But this would leave nearly three-fourths of the countries in the world economy outside of these arrangements. However, the lion's share of world output, trade, and investment lies with the countries that are negotiating the mega regionals. In the case of the recently concluded TPP agreement, 12 countries account for 40% of the world's GDP and 33% of the world's trade. For the TTIP, US and EU negotiations, these account for almost half of the world's GDP, 30% of global merchandise trade, and 40% of services world trade. And for the TiSA, the Trade and Services Agreement negotiations, the 50 countries negotiating account for 70% of world services trade. So the potential impact of these new agreements may well be very significant, and particularly so in the services area. Why services? For two reasons. One, because of their pervasiveness throughout these modern trade agreements. For example, in the TPP, fully one-third of the chapters concluded in the final agreement cover services or services-related issues or services in a horizontal fashion. And secondly, because of the economic importance of services in the world economy. We know that services account for two-thirds of our GDP on average worldwide, two-thirds of our employment, over 50% of world investment flows, and now we know that on a value-added basis, services account for over half of world trade. Many services are embodied in the goods that we trade as well as in our agricultural products, and measuring trade on a value-added basis allows us to have an understanding and a grasp of the real economic significance of services in trade. So for both of these reasons, because services are so important in the mega regional trade negotiations and the future agreements, and because they have such an incredible weight in the world's economy and in the world trade, we thought that it would be very important to examine specifically the potential impact of services resulting from these mega regional trade agreements. And so we've asked our panelists to think about and address the following two questions. The first one is, what will be the possible impact on non-member countries of these mega regional agreements in the area of services? And we can also include services and investment together in this context because they are so intimately linked. And secondly, what strategies and policy options are available to non-member countries in responding to these mega regional trade agreements? I want to emphasize at the outset that this is a brainstorming session. There has been no analysis or written study yet on this topic. And so we are actually in an ideas exchanging mode at this point in time. And I therefore want to doubly thank the panelists for their willingness to contribute to this brainstorming effort and for their creativity in thinking about this issue. So I'd like to introduce the speakers now. I would like to introduce them in the order in which they're going to speak. All right. Then I will turn first to Pascal Canais, who is the Managing Director of the European Services Forum and who has joined us here from Brussels. We thank him very much. He's been intimately involved in the TiSA negotiations from the outset. And his experience will be very valuable and insights in this regard. And then I would like to thank Harsha Singh, who, as everyone knows, has been the former Deputy Director General of the WTO and is now a senior associate with the ICTSD and has thought a lot about the question of standards and the mega regional agreements, what that might imply. Then I want to welcome Felipe Sandoval, who is here from Geneva. He is a counselor at the Mission of Chile to the WTO, and he's going to offer us a Latin American perspective on these questions. And I want to welcome Mia Michik, who is the Trade Policy Analysis Chief in the Trade and Investment Division of UNSCAP, and she's come here from Bangkok. We appreciate that, and she's going to give us an Asian perspective on these questions. I'd like to welcome Darlington Mwapi, who has joined us here from Zambia. He was the former WTO ambassador from Zambia, and he is now a senior fellow associated with the ICTSD, and he's going to give us an African perspective. And I'd like, finally, but last but not least, to welcome Teresa Carpenter, who is here from Geneva. She is the Executive Director of the Center for Trade and Economic Integration at the Graduate Institute of International and Development Studies in Geneva. And she's going to give us an academic perspective on these questions. So I've asked the speakers to speak for around 7 minutes each. And in that context, I've prepared some maybe questions that will provide some food for thought for them. And so since we're starting off with Pascal, and thank him for volunteering to be first, I'd like to ask him about how the outcome of the plurilateral trade and services TiSA negotiations, in which 50 countries that constitute 70% of world services trade might fit in with the new mega regional trade agreements that also, as we said, extensively cover services. The large majority of TiSA participants are also negotiating in the mega regionals. So what will be the relationship between the TiSA outcome and the outcome of the mega regionals and the mini services chapters? Will the latter influence the TiSA outcome? Will the TiSA be more or less ambitious? Will there be a possible convergence of disciplines? And lastly, will the TiSA be able to draw in new members so as to diminish the danger of regulatory exclusion that we see arising from the mega regional trade agreements? Thank you, Pascal.
Thank you, Sherry. So I'm from the European Services Forum, which is a lobby in Brussels. My members are trade association at European level in the different services sectors, plus multinational companies which are directly interested in these negotiations. I have indeed followed the TiSA negotiation from even before the name was invented. And I'm also an advisory member of the advisory group of the TTIP in the European Commission. So I'm covering the whole world. And the TiSA and TTIP are, of course, major agreements that we are following. Where are we in the TiSA? We believe that these negotiations are going rather well, at least at the technical level for the moment. All countries have put an offer on the table, including Pakistan and Mauritius the last time. There are now 23 countries around the table. Uruguay and Paraguay came in but decided to leave. As Sherry said, it is representing more than 70% of the world trade of services. For those of you who would have followed the negotiation yesterday about the ITA, you would know that when we talk about a critical mass, we tend to think about 90%. Here we're only 70%. And that is one of the reasons why TiSA is not included as a WTO agreement, but it is outside the WTO agreement. Despite the fact that most of the countries would like to have this into the WTO. And now they have actually started to negotiate into the WTO building, which is the first step. We would like to have more countries joining in. Actually, as a position of our organization, we argued that there was no need to have a new mandate, a new name. It could be part of the services part of the DDA, because in Hong Kong, ministerial declaration in 2005, in the Annex C, was clearly said that for the services, it was allowed to have plurilateral negotiation, i.e. the countries of the willing could go and continue negotiations. The problem is in the DDA, services has been, to my own views, taken hostage of the NAG, AG and NAMA, and therefore ministers have spent 4 hours on services. 4 hours in 10 years for 50% of world trade. This is simply not acceptable, and that is the reason why we have TiSA. So TiSA is a gathering of the countries of the willing. We have, in addition to the offers, we have 18 disciplines. That is a lot. That is probably too much. In the mega regionals and the normal FTAs, the countries usually negotiate among 6 to 7 disciplines. Some of them are well advanced in financial services, in telecom services, in domestic regulation, in transparency, in mode 4. All of that in professional services, all of these texts are nearly ready. The core text of the TiSA, which is built on the GATS structure, more than 70% of the TiSA text is going to be actually more or less a cut and paste of the GATS. Really on the insistence of the European Union countries and others who believe that we want at a point in time to be able to multilateralize the TiSA, i.e. to bring it down to the lake, as they say in Geneva, and to have it in the WTO ambit. If only because we don't know yet how a dispute settlement in TiSA will look like. If it is not part of the WTO dispute settlement, it's going to be a specific one, which is going to be more difficult to be convincing about the sanction part if we only have retaliation into the services sectors. I could come back later on if there are any questions on this. On the market access, countries have decided to table the best FTA. To be more precise, to table the best FTA ratified and implemented at the beginning of the negotiations. That is important because now TPP has been signed on, the EU has signed on EU-Canada and the CETA, and therefore the level of commitment in these regional negotiations are a bit higher than what is today on the table of the supposed to be best FTAs. The EU has tabled the EU-Korea FTA. The United States has tabled Korea-US FTA, CORIS. Since the world has changed, and we have CETA, which I will consider by far, by very, very far, the best FTA on the planet. But in between, because the agreement is concluded but not yet ratified, you know that in October, when was it again? TPP has been concluded recently, yeah. and that is a change maker. TPP is the biggest mega-regional agreement. TPP is de facto becoming the benchmark to our own despair. We consider that TPP in market access is not good, it's not impressive at all, and certainly not in the services sector. So will TPP become the benchmark or will TiSA become the benchmark? I am afraid that TiSA and TPP in terms of market access will be more or less the same. In disciplines, maybe TiSA will go further in some areas, and in others it might be more difficult. What we can see as very impressive into TPP is everything related to the digital products, digital world, digital economy, which is spread out in many different chapters. And that is something that we would like to have in either in TiSA or in TTIP. But we know in European Union there is a big debate on the data privacy and data protection. The regulation has been adopted yesterday or 2 days ago. So we will see what is going to be possible to move on. Now, I don't know where I am into the timing. So I probably should stop here, but just maybe to say, in the TTIP, if ever we will succeed, because we're not happy with the way it is going into the market access part, what we do in the mega regional for the European Union, the new generation, as I said, we cover services, and first services is in many sectors. For those who were listening to me yesterday in another panel, services in mode one for cross-border services for mode three for investment, services for mode four for mobility of people is going much beyond the services area, is touching the whole economy. And therefore, it's not only about services. But we look much further than services. We also look, as Sherry said, about investment, but also very much critical nowadays, and that is making the whole difference. This is actually the first priority of the European Union, public procurement. Public procurement in services is probably half of the new market access we have. Public procurement is not only about selling things to the government, but it's about selling services, IT services, banking services, accounting services, catering services, and therefore all of those services which are produced by services companies, plus the so-called construction and the works. Everything about architecture, engineering, construction services are services. So public procurement is very important. And the last sentence would be on an even further new generation agreement about regulatory cooperation and making things going living agreements, so that the regulators of the two countries will talk to each other, will see whether it is possible, by keeping the same standard of security of the consumers, etc., to see whether it is possible to reduce the cost by avoiding duplication of regulatory aspects, or pushing eventually to go for mutual recognition of, for instance, qualification of the professional services. So I stop here, thank you.
Thank you so much, Pascal. It's extremely interesting and excellent way to start us off in terms of the regulatory cooperation. Maybe we can come back to that aspect in our discussion and to see whether or not the TiSA would have the same ambitions as the TTIP sets out in this area, which we know are very high ones. And that's a very, very important area for services. And so let's turn now to our second speaker, Harsha Singh. And I'd like him, if possible, to address some of the questions related to the impact of the new mega-regionals in services, and regulatory standards. This may be actually one of their biggest areas of impact. The TiSA participants are negotiating in seven different services sectors, as well as 8 horizontal thematic issues, and all of these with a view to developing regulatory disciplines, which go clearly beyond what is in the GATS, and some of them will go beyond what is in most of the current PTAs. So the TPP as well has new chapters on sectoral disciplines. The TTIP certainly will also. How much of a challenge will these new sectoral and thematic agreements create for services exporters in non-member developing countries? Will the parties to mega-regional trade agreements actually be able to discriminate against third countries when implementing these new regulatory agreements? How much of a problem will it be for third countries if these regulatory disciplines for services and issues differ as between the TPP, the TTIP, RCEP, and the TiSA? And are we moving towards a spaghetti bowl of new regulatory frameworks for services? Thanks, Harsha.
Thank you. Hello. This is okay. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you very much, Sherry. I'll just first take your questions quickly and then share a few other thoughts. One on moving towards a spaghetti bowl of new regulatory frameworks. Those who know I'm an economist will not be surprised by my answer. My answer is yes and no. So yes, because it complicates the fundamental notion of spaghetti bowl is that it really complicates doing trade. I'm sorry. This is an urgent call. Hello, Radha. I'm speaking at a session. No. Sorry. No. My mother-in-law is in the Swiss embassy for a visa. This phone call relates to that. So I apologize. I just had to take it the second time it came. Yes, it'll make it more complicated. No, because with mega regionals, actually, there'll be fewer strands of spaghetti. So in that sense, the concentration on the kind of rules which will prevail will be much less fragmented. And second, I think TPP will, because the US is part of TPP, TPP will be used as a kind of model, not necessarily identical in every agreement US goes in, but it'll be the inspiration and a model for whatever now US negotiates. So this is the no part. The yes part is because of the fundamental concern that things will become more difficult. Which brings me to the question on whether the new regulatory standards will create complications. They will create complications in certain ways. What you have to understand is that when we are looking at regulatory standards for services, in a world of global value chains, it's not appropriate to understand the business implications by just looking at the regulatory standards of services, because goods also come in. And to the extent there are additional standards which are then reflected in the supply chain, and the supply chain then bears the impact of the private standard which is emphasized by a lead firm. The content of standards and the level of standards are likely to go up in certain parts. For example, the emphasis being given to environmental standards and social standards will be much higher as a result of this, in combination with certain other things. And I bring to your attention the G7 declaration of June this year, the governments, G7 governments, have emphasized that they will try very hard to ensure that their firms in their territory meet internationally recognized. So GAP is an internationally recognized standard, for example. Standards throughout their supply chain. So actually, the impact is going to be way beyond just the TPP countries. So it's far more complicated. The world of standards is far more complicated than just looking at the regulatory processes in services. However, within services, I think the provisions which are being emphasized or clarified will be useful. Pascal mentioned the issue of government procurement. What you agree in government procurement is actually a very good structure for good governance. And a lot of the regulatory provisions here basically go along the lines of what is good governance in terms of transparency, in terms of predictability, in terms of non-arbitrary policy framework, while allowing public policy objectives. So in some sense, what was, say, the telecom reference paper, it was voluntary. You could then schedule the elements in your schedule, is now today part of the main legal part. So you have expanded upon the nature of regulatory provisions, but the regulatory provisions are of two types, one which complicate and one which actually facilitate the conduct of business or predictability. But how do they become relevant? They become relevant in two different ways. I just talked of GVCs. Market access, straightforward, you can discriminate. If you want to discriminate, that's an area where you can very clearly discriminate. On the level of standards, the higher standard threshold makes it difficult for a lot of countries. Therefore, either they have FDI, if they are a very poor country, which then adds on, or they have training, or some combination of some of these two. Second is, if the standards, and please remember, I'm in a framework of GVCs, standard involves conformity assessment, there the element of discrimination can be quite significant. And that's where mutual recognition aspects become important. And in that context, the link between, say, TPP and TTIP becomes very significant. Because if there is some kind of regulatory coherence in TPP and TTIP, and it flows over into the other large market, that will be very beneficial. But if it does not, and one of the objectives of, say, TPP is to create a market segment for the TPP value chains, in which case you are explicitly recognizing a need to discriminate. So it's something which works both ways. Difficulties will increase, but in part, because of the common kind of disciplines, common thrust of disciplines, things will become easier to do. There are on whether if the if how much of a problem will it be for third countries differ between TPP, TTIP, RCEP, and TISA. So, as far as TPP and TTIP are concerned, and TISA, I think there'll be overlap, but not RCEP. RCEP is a different kind of agreement. And I think RCEP was more an effort, an answer to the political part of TPP rather than the economic part of TPP. And there was a lot of pressure to finish it before TPP did. TPP finished earlier than anticipated. So now I think the kind of pressure on RCEP is less. However, they have to wrap it up. What I point out to people is that 7 out of 16 RCEP members are in TPP, and 8th, South Korea, has applied. So that actually leaves 6 ASEAN, China, and India. And ASEAN is an economic zone focused on value chains. You cannot have 4 members with one kind of standards regime or regulatory regime, and 6 others with another one, and hope to have a seamless structure for value chains. So the others are going to, if not become members, at least follow that regime. And some of them, whom we didn't expect to jump on the bandwagon so quickly, like Indonesia, have actually announced their intention to do so. So all the 10 ASEAN will in effect be following these regulations. That leaves China and India. China, there is a debate on whether to join or not. However, they are very aware of the commercial implications, and they are preparing. You go to the Tianjin Economic Zone, and you will see not only a preparation for TPP, but for FTAP and beyond. So China is a very integral part of the global trade system. It's investing outside in a big way. It seeks high-value investment. High-value investment means high IPR. They are changing their IPR structures. They are actually ready for TPP in a fundamental manner, not in a political manner, because of certain core issues like state enterprise and TRIPS. We talk about regulations. In the context of regulations, we must bear in mind the TRIPS part also, because a lot of how the regulatory regime functions or is enabling depends also on the kind of rights and other kind of provisions which are there in TRIPS. Very quickly, I know I'm taking up a lot of my time, but one thing which I want to talk about is that TPP is actually a complicated agreement precisely because the relevant issues are discussed in many places. And you don't have, even what is emphasized, say, no local presence to be forced, is not uniform across every chapter. So you may have a different provision in financial services compared to telecom. Then another thing is that one has to be careful on what is the provision which overrides the others. For example, in Article 13.24 of telecom, it states if there is an inconsistency with any other chapter, this chapter prevails. So these are important things. Third, if you see electronic commerce or digital trade, electronic commerce is an area where a lot has been done to deal with issues, but it raises issues of sovereignty. It raises issues of not even knowing how the market will be 6 months hence. So market itself converges in unimaginable manner. And how do you regulate something which is a shifting ground for you, and you don't know how a regulatory regime of today will be able to cope with tomorrow? So you have to have a flexible part. One other aspect which I find very attractive in TPP is that they have developed a platform for exchange of information, for learning through success cases, to help SMEs. So these are the ways in which the future of trade regulation and business is actually going to find ways compatible with a world which we can't even anticipate will emerge tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Harsha. That was a lot of food for thought. I think that many of these things are now only becoming questions that we're pondering, and clearly the answers are complex, multifaceted, and as you say, depend yes and no on a large number of factors, but I think your point about we have to consider these questions in the context of a world of global value chains is really a point very well taken, because that's so true. Now let's turn to Felipe Sandoval, who will give us a Latin American perspective, and maybe I can start by asking him to consider a few questions. You may know that Latin America has become a divided continent for services liberalization and trade liberalization in general. Several countries on the Pacific have concluded FTAs with NAFTA members and with Asian trading partners, and have entered into the Pacific Alliance Agreement, with great emphasis on liberalizing services and a push to integrate further into GVC, or global value chain dynamics, with Asia. But much of the rest of Latin America, particularly on the Atlantic side, has not moved to make these links. How will the fact that certain Latin American countries are included in the TPP, and several are negotiating in the TISA as well, affect the possibilities for enhanced Latin American integration in services? Will there be a possible spillover or docking effects between existing agreements like the Pacific Alliance and the mega regionals? Or will the mega regionals on services just serve to divide the region even further? Thank you, Felipe.
Thank you, Chair. Well, let me provide a bit of context before going. Indeed, Pascal already introduced this issue, which is basically, why are we negotiating the TISA and other agreements instead of focusing all of our efforts at the WTO? And the answer to that, although it's logical at this point, is always worthwhile to restate it. It is because over 20 years, we have not been able to achieve any concrete results in the negotiating pillar at the WTO. And services, although it's one of those areas of trade at which, or in which, the differences of opinion and the distances among members are not that big, it's been taken hostage because of other pillars of the WTO large negotiation, the Doha round. So the natural alternative, although it's probably not the most desirable one, was to pull together groups or one group of like-minded members who would be willing to continue liberalization on the trade side, regardless of what happens or does not happen at the WTO. So this is the founding reason, principle behind the TISA negotiation. And I go further to say that this is probably not the reason for TISA, but also the reason for all of the other mega regionals or plurilaterals or bilaterals. Now, the advantage of going into a plurilateral or a bilateral is that you can conclude it quicker, that you conclude it among a group of like-minded, and almost by definition, market access and the rules will go deeper. Now, the trade-off to this is that you create further fragmentation of rules, is that, second, you will discriminate or marginalize those outside the treaties. And third, if you as a country are able to strike a deal with your major markets and partners, then what would then be the incentive for you to go back to the WTO and having to deal with another 161?
Why bother? I'm not willing to.
Going back to the first point. So it is in this context that TISA, the TTIP, the TPP, and the Pacific Alliance have taken a lead. Now, in terms of what happens in Latin America, basically, I'd say you could divide the region in three groups. There's one group of two members, Argentina and Brazil. And I'll pull those aside simply because of their magnitude. They are the largest markets in Latin America. Just to give you an idea, the Brazilian economy represents about two-thirds of the continent's economy. And in terms of size, especially for European friends, Brazil is 16 times Spain. That's how large it is. So that's the first group. The second group, you could put Venezuela, Bolivia, Ecuador, and this is a group of countries that represent smaller economies and who have not really engaged in a very intensive trade policy internationally. And on the third group, you've got Uruguay, Chile, and Paraguay, which are small economies who have tried to move forward to a more liberalized, homogeneous services atmosphere. Now, what happens with those Latin American countries that are not part to any of the large multilateral or plurilateral processes? Well, the obvious reply to this is you will be out of the game. But I think the most important question is to ask oneself, why is it that they're not in the game? Some argue that they're not in the game because they have been intentionally set aside, because they haven't been invited, because they weren't like-minded enough. The second group would argue that this has been basically a sovereign decision. And in my personal opinion, I think that it is the second option that better reflects what's been going on. Let's take, for example, the Brazilians. I think it would be very hard to argue that Brazil has not signed any other international trade treaty other than the WTO and Mercosur, because it wasn't invited or because nobody else had any interest in bringing Brazil on board. I think the reason why Brazil has not joined is because Brazil has a different agenda, and that agenda, whether we like it or not, has served their national interest. But now times are changing. We've gone through a major slowdown in world economy, and countries like Brazil and others who depended on very basic products, commodities mainly, are now facing a situation at which their economies are slowing down. They do not enjoy a great diversity of foreign markets, and they're not a party to any of the major trade agreements. So their reaction to be expected is that this changes. I'm a firm believer that Brazil and Argentina will kick off negotiating processes. Probably the first one they will see on the news, that it's already there, is the negotiation with the EU. But Brazil, it's been very aggressive in negotiating bilateral investment treaties, for example, under a domestic model, but yet the signal is very clear. I didn't time, so I have no idea how many minutes you have.
You have free time.
Okay, great. So that is the concrete effect. You are marginalized, either because you haven't been invited or because you choose to be outside. That means you're out of the game, of the negotiating game, of the rulemaking game. And yet, whether you like it or not, and whichever your position is, you will have to play by those rules. And this is, where the conversation, at least in my opinion, should be focused on. Are the new mega regionals and the RTAs in general just the kind of agreements that will affect trade among those who belong to them? Or are these indeed a new modality of quasi-multilateralism? I like to believe that is the second one. And I think that economic facts tend to sustain that position. Now this, of course, creates asymmetries that are not, or that are softened by a multilateral process, but again, the multilateral process and services has been a failure thus far. Let's say very clearly, we haven't achieved a single new rule under the GATS negotiations. Many texts, many discussions, yet no results. So, just conclude. Does this mean that the WTO negotiating pillar on services will never pick up again? Well, I think that's not the case. And I think that's not the case because the large emerging economies, including those in the Latin American region, will eventually have to play by the rules that are being set among these groups of mega regionals. And since those negotiating the mega regionals and those who set the mega regionals are at the end members of the WTO, all these rules will tend somehow to converge. And the natural place for these rules to converge is not at the end a larger mega regional, but the WTO. Now, I think there are other reasons as well. The dispute settlement mechanism at the WTO, I think it has a very big role to play in terms of providing everyone with clarity on the same set of rules. So basically what's happening is that we have taken a different path, a deviation, but at the end we have to go around the circle and come back to the WTO. The question is not if, the question is when and how long this is going to take.
Very good. Thanks very much. I like the optimistic way in which you ended the remarks, and let's hope that that is indeed how we see these processes converging in the end. I would now like to ask Mia Micic, who's joined us from UNSCAP, if she could give us an Asian perspective on these questions of mega-regionals and their services impact. Particularly because services are so important for East Asia due to their role in supporting the dynamic operations of global value chains. This is a very dynamic region for global value chains. We know that RCEP, in fact, is focused quite prominently in the negotiations on supporting the operation of these value chains. But four ASEAN members have negotiated the TPP, and as we heard Harsha say, Indonesia has already expressed its interest in joining, so have the Philippines.
Seven RCEP
members. But none of these countries, ASEAN.
Okay.
But none of these countries, and seven RCEP, but none of these countries has chosen to be a part of the TiSA discussion so far, so that's actually very interesting. But all of them are in RCEP, which should, in principle, be led by ASEAN. So how will the conclusion, Mia, of the TPP with its numerous chapters containing deep disciplines on services affect these very dynamic GVC operations in the East Asian region? Will China push harder for RCEP now that TPP is concluded and that it is not participating in the TiSA? And how will the ambitions of RCEP in services be influenced by the recently concluded TPP?
Thank you very much, Sherry. Let me just try to set my time counter. I'm looking at the iPad because I want to stay focused on the questions that Sherry has given me, but in connection to what was already said, because other speakers have covered some of the parts of the questions that Sherry asked, maybe I may sound repetitive, or you will see how it may contrast to what was said on particular issues. I'm very glad also that Sherry said that this is pretty much brainstorming session, and that not much research has been done on the implications or based on an economic analysis of impact of TPP on the economic and trade and investment flows in the region. The reason for that being is that TPP text has been released only recently in early November, and so there was simply not enough time to engage research community into producing results. And if you take into account that a TPP with its 30 chapters covers 1,200 pages, and then when you take into account individual countries' chapters, it is another 5,000 pages. It will rather take a long time to convert that text into the economic modeling language and variables in order to ascertain what the possible impacts on the production, trade, investment flows, et cetera, and welfare there are. But let me start with part of the of Sherry's questions, where she said that services are extremely important for Asian economies. Sherry said East Asian economies. I come from an organization that covers 58 Asian economies, Asian Pacific economies, from Turkey to Pacific. And so if Latin America is fragmented, Asia is even more so, because we really have a different type of economies in our under our coverage, from Central Asian economies that are mostly landlocked to really, to small islands in the Pacific, to those that Sherry referred to in East and Southeast Asia that are interlinked in the global value chains. And of course, we know how important services for them are, because it's obvious from their success so far. But it is not to say that services are not important for the others. And we have actually done a little research on that. Allow me to advertise our product. Some of the copies of this report are in the back of the room. It's in the Asia Pacific Trade and Investment Report that we have not only analyzed the relevance of services for industrial export of our countries, but also went further into trying to tease out how relevant are regional trade agreements for their increasing participation in global value chains. And so if you look only at services, you come up now with the figure that about 30% of industrial export of Asian economies is in one way or the other related to services. And then another 30% of that is actually coming from importation of services. So we are here talking about, of course, of services that are used as intermediates, as inputs into the production, and therefore define the relative competitiveness of countries in their final products or other services as well. Because these services are very important for example, tourism sector, that is extremely, that is essential for the development concerns of our countries in the region. So going from a realization of that, and this is an eye-opener, because when you go through our region, you will find still people that are very much focused on industrialization, manufacturing, and development of a solid production based of manufacturing, rather than looking at paying giving any policy attention to the services sector. Going from there, we wanted to see how various variables affect the participation of countries in the global value chains. And why I'm bringing it here is the question that Sherry asked is about how will country react on TPP and whether they will try to sign other agreements, etc. So what it turns out to be is that not every country actually needs free trade agreement to participate in global value chains. So when we split countries in Asia to high-income countries, middle-income countries, and low-income countries, what is found is that these high-income countries and middle-income countries are already integrated in global value chains because of the business interactions and because of the multinational companies taking care of that, even if they don't have FTA among the economies, right? So it is only for the low-income countries that are not participating in global value chains that concluding new free trade agreements will actually make a difference in terms of how they can improve their chances to participate in global value chains. And what we know from what was said so far this morning is that these countries in particular are excluded from the FTAs that would that would enable them to develop activities that are involved in global value chains. Whether they are excluded on their own design, as was said for Latin America, or they are excluded because they are simply not necessarily like-minded, but they don't have economic size that is attractive enough to go through the pain of negotiating with them, and therefore they are just bypassed in many cases. So going from there and understanding how important services are for building competitive strength of the smaller and low-income economies, let me go to what is happening in the region with interplay between TPP and RCEP and some other agreements. It was said here that TPP now is seen as a standard maker, right? And that possibly whether it is good for the good or bad, we still don't know, but it is being seen as that. There are many countries in the region that simply have no capacity to reach that standard, right? So their current regulatory regimes is so distant from the standard that TPP has that it is very hard to see how they would be able to integrate into that. So they may be completely for a longer period of time bypassed. But there are economies that are close by, and the names of these economies were mentioned already. It is Indonesia that announced that they want to join TPP from the ASEAN countries. It is also Thailand. To surprise of many, it was Cambodia as well that very explicitly and formally said we want to go into TPP without knowing really what that means. And then obviously there is the big elephant in the room is China. Now you will, as it was hinted here in the discussions, the motivation for TPP might have been to bypass China in its Asian influence, because all these value chains that were mentioned in the morning and in my discussion are actually not within the ASEAN countries only. And if it were only between the ASEAN 10, they wouldn't go really far. They are actually between them and China, and they are between them and, in some part, involvement of Korean and Japanese firms. Leaving China outside any future arrangements would, I think, hinder the long-term interests of these countries. But the question is then how to bring China back into the conversation, and there are various scenarios that are being discussed. One, of course, is RCEP that was mentioned, which was supposed to be concluded before TPP. Actually by the end of this year, but at the 10th negotiating round in October, just a week after TPP was concluded, not much progress was done. And now when you see which countries are involved in that, it was supposed to be led by ASEAN centrality, but obviously you have other six ASEAN development partners that are involved in China, of course, India, Republic of Korea, Japan, and Australia and New Zealand. And while Australia and New Zealand, being in TPP, are already sort of, and Japan, already players in the game to bring RCEP closer to TPP standards, you have these India and China interplay that In many ways it is political. As you know, they started negotiating a bilateral deal, but could not progress. And then you also have some issues in between China, Korea, and Japan, that may be a factor in this game. The good news is that China and Korea have done the bilateral deal. The good news is that there is a trilateral investment deal between China investment and Japan, and that these can form the sort of a platform from which they can bring some impetus into the RCEP. But how will that play out? We don't know. And I think all of this conversation is a little bit not fully informed brainstorming, because we haven't had experience with mega regionals so far, right? None of these mega regionals that were mentioned is in implementation. TTIP may not come into implementation until 26 months or so from now, right? And so the best estimates where these new countries can join TPP would be in, four or five years. By that, global economy is changing. And there are different needs, and there could be different dynamics, completely with China now getting a bigger role even in the financial architecture, etc. So to close, because my time is already spent, Sherry also asked, how what would be the best solution out of this? And I have to agree with what was said before here. The best solution would be to have multilateral rules for services. That would be best for the type of trade that we have today, which is through the tasks, through role of services and investment, also with the predominant role of regulatory barriers that exist rather than the border barriers. So I think the movement on the multilateral level would actually be best for the Asian economies. Thank you, Sherry, for being patient with me on the time.
Thank you so much, Mia. All of these are very insightful. I do know, indeed, that we don't yet have experience with how the mega regionals are going to impact the world economy, because they're not yet, none of them have been implemented, and so it is a little bit down the road, but we know they're coming, and even the fact that they've been negotiated and that we have these chapters ahead of us, and we can actually look concretely at what is in the TPP may already provide an impetus for some countries to start looking at how they might change their standards or regulations to be more in conformity with this. As you mentioned, several of the ASEAN members have already expressed formally an interest. We can imagine that maybe that would push them already in this direction. So, we're really in a brainstorming mode very much, but thank you so much. Now we turn to an African perspective. We're very happy that Darlington Mawapi is here with us. We'd like to ask if he could brainstorm with us on how Africa might be influenced by the treatment of services in the TPP and in these ongoing mega-regional negotiations, particularly for its future continental free trade agreement, the CFTA, Continental Free Trade Agreement, that will actually begin to be negotiated next month in January 2016, and which has a very tight deadline, which minister or head of state have set for the end of 2017. Interestingly enough, the CFTA is going to cover services as well as goods. It will incorporate all of the 54 members of the African Union and potentially could represent another mega regional, at least in terms of the number of countries. So is there a concern in Africa right now about their potential marginalization because of the TPP and other mega regionals in services? And why have no African countries other than Mauritius chosen to engage in the TiSA negotiations in Geneva, particularly if these might be a learning environment for dealing with modern services issues? So thank you.
Thank you, Sherry, and I'm pleased for you to have me here. just to pick up on the point that you stated that the CFTA is likely to be another mega regional. Of course, it will be a big regional. I'm not so sure if it will be a mega regional. You know, at the moment, consensus about the definition of a mega regional is you know, there's no agreed definition, but there's consensus around the elements that you know, you should have at least 25% share of global trade, and that you should be dealing with issues beyond the WTO agenda. So I'm not so sure that Africa will have the 25% share. Mega regionals and RRTAs generally, I think, will continue to be on the increase given the current multilateral trading environment. If you look at the WTO notifications, I think that we are about 600 plus RTAs notified, with 400 that are active, and mostly of these are bilaterals. When we discuss, you know, mega regionals, I often hear a tone of complaint, you know, of being left out by those that are not part to these negotiations. But we have to face some facts. One of those facts is that RRTAs are, by their very nature, exclusionary. They have to exclude some people, otherwise they will not be regionals in nature. So this is not a multilateral process. It's about countries are so-called like-minded. So exclusion is inevitable. The important issue, however, is the question that we are faced with. It's consideration of the question of implication of the ones that are not part to these negotiations, and how they can respond. If we look at the recently concluded TPP, of course, we note that the countries involved in the TPP control 38% of world trade in services. So this is a significant number to consider the implications to global trade in services. To set the tone on the implications, we just have to go to the political statements that have been pronounced. One such statement was pronounced by you know, Vice President Biden, who said, and I quote, "Our goal is for TPP to enter the bloodstream of the global system and improve rules and norms." The ultimate goal is to multilateralize these rules and norms that are being negotiated in these mega regionals. And this obviously is inevitable considering the share that is controlled by these countries that are party to these negotiations. So we have to be alive to the fact that the extension of these new rules and standards to the multilateral system is obviously inevitable. The question is that how do we respond? For Africa, while Africa's you know, share in global services trade may be minimal at 2%, and for LDCs, which I constituency I represented in my previous incarnation, at 0.5%. However, the importance of services trade continues to be very vital to the growth of these African countries and LDCs. If you look at African continent, for instance, you know, 30 of 54 African countries had their services contributed to like more than 50% of their GDP, and 12 of those had 70% contribution from services. So services are continue to be very important, and therefore paying attention to how services trade at a global and regional level are evolving for African LDCs is particularly important. Now, in terms of the possible responses to mega regionals for Africa, I think that the best possible option is unilateral reform and adjustment. I mean, you cannot wait for the world to move while you are waiting for the multilateral negotiations to conclude. You have the space as Africa or LDCs to take certain unilateral reforms, regulatory reforms, policy reforms, you know, legal reforms, in order to adjust to the global trends. The second best option, in my view, is to deepen integration within Africa, and this but this deepening of integration. We have seen on the continent that what has been happening is more of widening regional integration rather than deepening regional integration, and this is reflective in the low level of trade between African countries. It means that there is a lot of barriers, so the integration is not being deepened, but we are having widening of integration, and this has to do with implementation and coherence in policies and regulation. The third option is to leverage where African countries have some advantage and enter into global value chains. Of course, global value chains, as the last speaker said, you do not require to be part of the agreement to enter a global value chain. It is a chain which is available. If you have comparative advantage, you can use that advantage to have an entry point in a value chain, be it in goods or services. Now, of course, going back to my previous point of regional integration, as Sherry has noted, the Continental Free Trade Agreement is supposed to be concluded as per timeline by the African Union. It's supposed to be concluded in 2017. Their decision was made in 2012, so it gave 5 years to negotiate and conclude this. Of course, now we are at the end of 2015, and we're talking about 2 years. It's very ambitious to say the least. The goodness is that with the CFTA, as opposed to the approach that was taken in the tripartite free trade agreement. The tripartite free trade agreement is the agreement that brings together EAC, SADC, and COMESA. The approach there was to negotiate goods first, and then second phase negotiate services. The CFT has taken a different approach. They are going to negotiate goods and services concurrently. And this is in recognition of the new trend, the new approach to trade, that services and goods should be considered together because they complement each other. You can't compartmentalize the discussion. So this is a very good approach that the CFTA is taking. Now, when it comes to the TISA negotiations that my colleagues have talked about, you have to recognize the context that 34 of these African countries are LDCs. So the approach that Africa takes that aspect into consideration. One of the issues that, of course, affect the LDCs from mega regionals is an issue of erosion, preference erosion. As you are aware, recently the LDCs had benefit of the services waiver, and countries have started advancing preferences and have notified the WTO. But with coming on stream of the TPP, we really need to do studies on how, for instance, the market access that has been negotiated under TPP affects the preferences that have been notified by the countries that are involved in TPP. For instance, one would look at the Chapter 10 TPP negative list and see whether that list preserves the preferences that have been notified under the WTO. We don't know yet because this is new information and work needs to be done in this regard. I think it will be very helpful for LDCs if work could be done in this regard. Now, the question, why aren't African countries, I'll conclude soon. Why aren't African countries not participating in TISA? Four quick thoughts from me. One is Africa tends to have a policy disconnect, and this is an area where Africans should improve. I'll give you an example. For instance, Kenya and Senegal have prioritized BPOs as priority sectors. However, if you look at their GATS priority, if you look at their GATS schedule, you will not see this reflective in those schedules. So there's that disconnect. And also, ICT is very big in East Africa, but you will not see that reflective in their regional frameworks. So those disconnect needs to be cured. Therefore, this also translates to the multilateral system, where you have priorities, but you are not reflecting them at the multilateral level. We can extend these examples to the trade facilitation agreement, for instance, which is important to Africa, but is not being ratified at the rate it should be. Because of 34 countries being LDCs, they have advantage of the benefits to the from the LDC modalities, which by the way, I do not entirely agree with, because once you are excluded from taking commitments, then you do not have the appetite to make the reforms that are required in that sector. So. I've got my reservations on those 2003 modalities. The third point is that Africa at a political level prefers multilateral approach to plurilateral approach. So that is the third reason. The fourth one is the lack of incentive to participate in TISA, because there has been pronouncements from some big players who are involved in TISA that they will extend the benefits negotiated out of TISA to say LDCs. So that doesn't give the incentive for one to go to the table. So those are the four quick reasons I could give you why this set of countries are not participating in TISA. Thank you, Sherry, and sorry for extending my privilege.
Thank you very much, Darlington. I really appreciate that you addressed all the questions and very thoughtfully. And I think that was a really, really interesting contribution. Appreciate it. Now let's turn to our academic perspective. And I'd like to give as much time as she needs to Teresa Carpenter, who is going to talk to us about the implications of the mega-regional agreements for investment and the operation of global value chains. As we know, the value chains currently exclude most developing countries and developing regions, partly because their services are not as commercially competitive as the services of exported by other countries. And so will these new mega regionals impact on current GVC patterns of trade through new rules of origin for services, or more explicitly through inciting new FDI into the mega regional areas and diverting it from other areas in the world economy?
Not as discriminatory as you would first think. And here I'm drawing on some ideas for work by Joost Paulin and Petros Mavroidis, who have written some papers on this. So the first reason that they are not as discriminatory is that some regulations simply cannot be set preferentially. These are things like transparency or commitments on subsidies, competition rules, or anti-corruption clauses. You can't discriminate against non-members when you have clauses like that. The second reason that these agreements will not be discriminatory against third parties are for voluntary reasons. Quite often, some of these clauses are simply implemented on an MFN nature, even though they don't have to be. The third thing is that there may be MFN clauses that apply to some areas. For example, in TRIPS, there's no exception for FTAs. If you extend intellectual property commitments, then that to FTA partners, those automatically apply on an MFN basis due to WTO rules. And the fourth reason why these RTAs will not be as discriminatory is that sometimes it's hard to identify the origin, particularly for service providers, so that third country providers will naturally benefit from provisions that are extended in an FTA. Now, to understand the services impact of, say, TTIP and TISA when it comes out, on developing countries or on excluded parties, there you would have to look line by line or provision by provision, and you'd be looking at the current national practice as it's actually practiced and compare that with a new commitment. First of all, is there actually a gap between the commitment and what is currently being done? And then will the new commitment be implemented in a discriminatory way or not? So for to understand whether there's any discrimination against excluded parties or not, it would take quite a bit of analysis. So that's lots of research ideas for our students and for anyone else who's looking for a dissertation topic. But certainly TPP, TTIP, and TISA may well be less discriminatory against non-members than might originally be thought. Now, my second takeaway relates to the trade, investment, and service nexus and the impact of developing countries of participating in global value chains. And there the question to me was, will the provisions of mega-regionals exaggerate the current practice of exclusion? And there I think the answer might be, unfortunately, yes. And the reason, I'm going to explain how that can work, even when there's no intended discrimination. So over the past few years, I've been involved in research in global value chains, working with Richard Baldwin and a number of students who specialize on that. And we can talk about the links between trade, investment, and services, and this nexus that all three things go together. And one of the questions that pops up now and again on a panel is, how does a country join a value chain? So here I'd like to turn it round a little bit and draw on some of my previous experience in management consulting. Now, countries don't join value chains. Firms make investment decisions. Sometimes they make location choices. Now, some investment clearly is resource-led. There's always going to be investment in oil countries, no matter what their policies are. Others are market-led. If you've got a big country, people are going to want to come and invest. But much investment these days is footloose, and it really could be almost anywhere. So the question there is, how do firms decide where to put it, where to locate it? And what they do there is a careful investigation of a few shortlisted locations. And three things come up in that investigation. The first thing is availability of appropriate labor. A firm will always look for the right people to be available with the right training. The second thing is overall costs, and there will be a full cost comparison and cost analysis. And the third thing is, I'm going to say other factors, but other factors that can that then, where possible, get expressed as a monetary equivalent. And I think what I think the question really is, how does a country get onto a shortlist? And I think TPP countries tend to be well integrated. It's going to be relatively easy for countries that sign up to business-friendly policies are much more likely to be on a shortlist and are more likely to be recipients of inward investment from footloose projects. And I do agree with the previous speaker, business doesn't need trade agreements, it just needs consistent policies. And Factory Asia involved in the complete absence of trade agreements between those countries. Yes, there was ASEAN, but it wasn't really very effective or very useful, and still it evolved. So the real danger for countries not participating in some of the global agreements and are also not trying to have a set of transparent and coherent business-friendly policies is that they simply won't be on the shortlist. And the third point is, what are the strategies for non-members? Well, here I think it's quite simple to come up with a list. They can either implement similar regulatory practices unilaterally if they want to. There's nothing to stop them. Another thing is they can accede to an existing agreement, and TPP does have an accession clause, although I'm sure that's going to be every bit as difficult as getting into the WTO for some countries, but certainly it's there. Another alternative could be join another mega group such as RCEP, and there we wait to see what kind of thing will come out of that. And the fourth alternative is to discuss it in the WTO. And everyone agrees that multilateralism is better. And I do think that eventually these agreements will come back. And a very simple way forward would be to simply get rid of the provision that insists on consensus to even discuss a plurilateral. Why can't a plurilateral be discussed at the WTO as part of Annex 4? It's really a pity that it can't. And that's my third takeaway. Thank you. Okay, I think I'm out of time. Thank you, Sherry.
Excellent, Teresa. These are really, really thoughtful remarks and very, very much to the point. And I think you've put some really useful ideas on the table, particularly in terms of how countries that are not part of these mega regional agreements can actually respond effectively. And I think that was extremely useful for everyone present and a nice complement to the regional perspectives that we heard. So thank you so much. And I'd now like to know how much time we still have.
10 minutes.
10 minutes, at least. Maybe we can push to 15, if Simon is nice and generous. Okay, so that means that we have some time for questions from the audience. And then I know Harsha wants to make two points and wrap up. Maybe others do, but we don't have too much time for wrap up since our panel has taken a lot of time. So I'd really prefer to give you the chance to talk. So do we have any questions from the floor? Please, I'll start with the lady here.
Thank you very much. Joan Fubbs, Chair of Trade and Industry, Parliament, South Africa. Now, for some time we have been saying we cannot separate goods and services, especially if your priority is productive investment, because we all know what hot investment is like. It comes and goes, etc. So I know that that was pointed out by a number of people, and the points about plurilateralism and exclusion, I don't believe they ever, in the medium to long term, add any value whatsoever. In fact, I think they're highly dangerous because they do tend to push out rather than bring in. The last point one would like to make is the issue of you all sort of tend to flirt around the multilateralism and say, as you wind up, and then yes, this will lead to further support for multilateralism. Doesn't sound like anyone wants to get rid of it, and yet many of the points made have the risk of undermining multilateralism. And I think that is a very big danger. Thank you.
Excellent. I'm going to take a round of questions, and then I'm going to give each of the panelists a chance to address whichever ones they can in their closing. Thank you.
Yeah, my name is Helen. I just have a question related to Africa's participation in services negotiations and Africa's capacity as well. As Ambassador Mwape correctly pointed out, Africa is actually mostly interested in widening as opposed to deepening integration. And in most of the regional trade agreements that have already been concluded, the emphasis is actually on trade in goods and less in services. We look at the tripartite, and services negotiations were actually supposed to be phase two. I'm not sure how far they are now. As much as in the CFTA, services are going to be negotiated concurrently with goods, I'm just not sure how practical that is given, one, I think Africa's capacity and even interest. We have just been told that in the TISA negotiations, only one African country has already expressed interest and has already joined. So I'm just wondering, in your analysis, do you think Africa has the capacity and the interest to really get involved in services negotiations right from the regional level and even up to the multilateral level, or even beyond the regional level? Because I don't see that commitment at all from African countries.
Thank you very much. Another question, please.
Desmond McNeil from University of Oslo in Norway. Thank you very much indeed. I had a question, I suppose, best for Felipe Sandoval Zamorano, because I just very broadly, what do you see the role of the WTO in a few years' time? I mean, as I understood it, Sherry Stevenson said that when you say we have to come back to the WTO, this is optimistic. But I mean, another interpretation is the opposite, to say it comes back to the WTO when, in the sense, the game's over, when all the important decisions have been taken. So what do you see as the role of the WTO? And do you interpret it as optimistically as Sherry does?
Thank you very much. Do we have a couple more before we ask our panel to comment? Any question is welcome. No? Going gone. Okay. So then I'm going to go in the order of our speakers and allow them to make final remarks. Pascal.
Thank you. I guess in the short time I'd like just to come back to what Teresa said about how a decision is taken in a company about foreign direct investment. And I agree fully with her own criteria. I put that question to some people writing the memo for the CEOs and the member of the board of a company to say, what kind of criteria are you looking at? And indeed, whether a country has an FTA or not is certainly not on the top of the list. Indeed, the labor question, indeed, the skills, indeed, the tax incentive, indeed, all the cost overall, the competition with other companies in the same sector. They're going to look at whether the regulation which are in place, whether they exist, whether they are implemented, whether there are corruption or not. But every time, every single time, whether it's going to be a number one or two or number 15, you will have one criteria called risk country assessment. And in that, you will see whether you have, if it is a democratic country, if you have the respect of the rules of law. And one of the criteria would be that country has signed an FTA, that country has taken commitment in WTO, that country has signed a bilateral investment treaty, and therefore is willing internationally to commit itself to respect what it has agreed upon. It is only a signal, because sometimes these things are not implemented when you have a change of government. You always have the risk. But that is part of it. So I think what I wanted to say from the business perspective, it is true that the FTA or the mega regionals are not meant to give discrimination. And it is true that the commitment usually are implemented on an MFN basis. But nevertheless, I used to say an FTA is a one full page advertisement in the Financial Times. Mm-hmm. This is what it is. It's just a call from the country to say, I am open and I am willing for you, FDI, you foreign direct investor, to come invest in my country. And I'm giving you this guarantee because I signing this international treaty. This is what it is about. I'll stop here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very quickly, 3 points. But before I share those three thoughts with you, some of them my disagreements with my esteemed panel members here. But I want to give you two quotations from John Maynard Keynes, who's a person I really admire and love to read about. One, he said, the difficulty lies not so much in developing new ideas as in escaping from old ones. And then he was talking to someone and he said, when my information changes, I alter my conclusion. What do you do, sir? So that's what we are facing today. And I think extension to multilateral is inevitable, but under certain conditions. There's a reason why the TPP has been negotiated. The industry feels that the level playing field is not in place because of standards not being followed in the same way, whether it's social, environmental, or any other standard. That is not level playing field because some enterprises are provided subsidies which they are not being able to get. So if you see the provisions of the TPP, whether it's electronic commerce, where it's the software code, etc., it's trying to create a level playing field from the perception of the industry of a particular large nation. Those conditions and worries will not go away. And you cannot then say, okay, in a multilateral, I will agree to something else which is not the level playing field which I want. So without those conditions, you're not going to get a multilateral. That's the basic point. How do you manage that? Because not everybody will be able to meet it, is the issue. And there, the multilateral system itself needs to change, evaluate, and come up with issues such as, can we have a solution where not everybody, so you have a plurilateral with MFN kind of thing, you have something where there is a threshold beyond which, because the free rider problem is there, threshold beyond which, if you don't meet the conditions, you are not getting all the goodies, you are not, you will not get the benefit. So those kind of ideas will have to be addressed. Without that, multilateralism is not inevitable. So that's my first point. My second point is that, yes, you do not require to be part of an agreement to be part of a value chain. In fact, trade diversion is never trade exclusion. It only makes it more difficult for you to access the market. Then you have to say, okay, if the market access conditions have become more difficult, what are they? It's not so much tariff today. The developed countries have, in general, very low tariffs, except some sectors, which are important to developing countries, but in general. It's the NTMs. So is it that the standards will not be exclusionary, or the systems will not be exclusionary? This is where I don't agree with my friends Joost and Petros. You may think that you are applying everything MFN, but what do? You actually end up with standards which are high. So LDCs or less developed countries don't find it difficult to get in because the standard is being applied in the same manner to them also. It's because they don't have the capacity to meet that higher standard. So that's an additional cost. Then voluntary standards. Private standards are voluntary, but they are going to be high. I pointed out to G7 declaration, please look at it. There's a section on responsible supply chains. If you don't meet the standards in the supply chain, yes, you are free to join it. You won't be able to join it. So, and the third is, origin is sometimes difficult, yes, but origin is often in goods not so difficult. And in a supply chain context, that is not the case. So deep agreements are actually going to be discriminatory, whether we like it or not. And a lot of link will be with digital trade, electronic commerce, and there it's going to be much more difficult. On RCEP, you know, all mega regionals are not the same. RCEP is a regional integration mega regional. It is not a mega regional which will develop standards for world trade. I was at a podium with the Malaysian minister, and he said, you'll ask me why am I in RCEP and in TPP? I'm in RCEP because it involves regional integration. I'm in TPP because it will formulate the world's trade systems and rules, which will be the order of the day in global markets. That's the difference between these two, and that's the model for tomorrow. And if we are complacent that they're not going to be discriminatory, that we will not face market access problems, I think that's the wrong attitude to take. Thank you.
So many issues, so little time. Okay. Well, first of all, Harsha, I think we agree. You just didn't read that paper.
No, no.
Because if you have read that paper,
I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm disagreeing with my friend here. through her with my friends Joost and Petros, with whom I've argued this, but they somehow feel that it's not the case.
Well, thank you for that. Yes, I do agree. FTAs and particularly mega regionals are mostly about consistency and coherence. Their main focus is on rules. It's not on market access. Now, the problem, as you well described it, is, you know, even if those standards, those rules that I agree, apply to everyone, well, but only some will be in a position to meet them. Not all. And there is discrimination, de facto discrimination through this channel. That is a fact. So the question is, what do we do about it? How do we go about it in the future? On the questions, do we undermine the multilateral trading system? Well,
I don't agree.
The easy reply to that is
that's
yes.
Not the way the market
it's measurable.
Look at your second point on investment.
No, actually identified. But that is an unfair question. Because in that question, you're seeing facts that are not there. And
so your point
by implying that there is an intentionality to undermine the system, I would understand that there is also a possibility for me not to go on the plurilateral or the bilateral path, but to rather stay in the multilateral path. That is not a real option, because the multilateral path of services is not delivered and has not delivered in over 20 years. So for a country like Chile, super globalized, representing 0.3% of global economy, that is the only alternative. So this is a very interesting debate in theory, but in practice, it just doesn't make it. Yeah, and one more point, WTO in the future. The way I see it is, it's like this. After the ministerial, we either go into a very long cold winter where nothing happens, or we begin on the plurilateral path. And the question will be whether members of the WTO will be willing to maintain the plurilateral negotiations within the framework of Marrakesh. Otherwise, we'll end up with many other RTAs outside the WTO, which will take much longer to come back to the system. So, yeah.
Thank you. Just 30 seconds, Sherry. I know that we are very out of time now. I think what I agree with my speakers and what was hinted here is that countries will indeed help themselves by strengthening unilaterally their regulatory system, which will make them more confident and to bind those at the multilateral level. And so this is the recipe for all. I also, in terms of the relevance of multilateral and how it's going to go forward, I agree here that there is a huge distance between what we need today for the economies, which is GVC, services, investment, and the mobility of labor and competition. None of that is on the agenda, or not sufficiently, at the WTO. So it is up to the members to really decide to put it on the table. And if they do, then we will have a much stronger multilateral solution. Otherwise, it will fragment down to what we have now.
Thank you very much.
Please, Darlington and Teresa.
Yeah, specifically on Africa's, Africa got capacity and interest to participate in these negotiations. Africa has capacity, and I think that after so many years of capacity building? The answer is yes, Africa has capacity. The problem that Africa faces is not able to walk its talk, seeing its interests through to implementation and coherence are Africa's major problems. Because, for instance, if Africa has an interest in a particular area, they will argue, they will see its decision passed, but they will not go through beyond. For instance, now for LDCs is in place. Preferences have been granted by some countries. What are LDCs doing on their side to make sure that they benefit from those preferences?
Excellent. Okay, thank you. So I'll just take 30 seconds. The question was, what do you see the role of the WTO in the future? So I think there's a serious danger that the WTO will be marginalized in many ways. I've been reading the TPP over the past couple of days on the plane and in preparation for this, and what I think and what I thought before is that if members of the WTO, what I thought before is that if members of the WTO can't find a way to discuss issues that matter to some members within the WTO, then those members will find a way to discuss it elsewhere. And with the conclusion of TPP, that's very much what's happened. And we have, and TiSA, sorry, I haven't read TiSA, I was just talking about what I've been reading, sorry. We do have another panel this afternoon on TPP, mega regionals, and the relationship with the WTO, so I'm sure we'll have some more nuanced discussion there this afternoon. Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you very much to all the panel. It's been a fascinating, stimulating discussion. I think we could be here several more hours. We've just started to scratch the surface. Clearly, these are issues that absolutely demand our attention from countries in all regions of the world, all levels of development, but particularly on the part of those that are outside of these agreements. But also we heard in this panel that it's not just the individual countries and agreements, it's a whole multilateral trade system that needs to reflect on how to move forward in a more effective way if the WTO is not going to be marginalized as well by what is happening in the world economy. So I just want to extend my thanks to all the panelists. Thank you for thinking about these questions seriously and doing such a great job in analyzing them. Thank you.